It is challenging to buy beauty because beauty is a massive industry where there are literally millions of different products. And as consumers and as smart consumers, my co-founder and I thought, there's got to be a better way.
What is it that Birchbox has done to stay in the game for so long while all of these other, you know, competitors or others have come along?
It's that we think relevance is something that you have to really fight for. Mm. You know, we never started Birchbox to be a subscription company. We always started it with a big idea, and we recognized that there was a huge opportunity, that basically by making the option set feel digestible and making it really about enjoying the process of discovery instead of like the daunting activity of like, should I be updating something? Should I change something? That is what we really wanted to achieve. And we realized that a subscription would help us do that.
The challenge really is staying relevant.
Absolutely.
And that ultimately comes down to being relevant to your customer and having a really strong understanding of who that is. How did you think about that when you were getting Birchbox off the ground, of deciding who is the ideal customer, and then how have you gotten to know her and even him at this point better as you've grown?
When we started, we didn't know who the customer would be, of course, mm-hmm. right? We didn't quite know. We just leaned into what we wanted as consumers without really thinking, who's your target customer? And then a couple of years in, we did a study to say, okay, what's the beauty ecosystem in retail and where do we fit in? We realized that, wow, we wildly over-index in serving this casual consumer. So from that moment, we really adjusted our thinking at the company to say, this isn't just an opportunity to facilitate a consumer's discovery. We are going to become the destination place for the casual beauty consumer who has been no one's priority, is spending in beauty, and really deserves to be considered.
And how did you, from the very beginning, think about, you know, what would she like to see, what's going to appeal to her?
Yeah.
And then, you know, even like moving into men, like what would he like to see, what's going to appeal to
right.
him?
Well, in the early days, we leveraged one of our friends from business schools who was a brand strategist and asked her to help us. And she introduced us to someone to come in and did a quick, you know, just tightening of our thinking. So we crystallized what we envisioned this customer to be actually in the early days when we were sitting at a lunch table in another office. We named our target customer Sam. We talked about her, you know, desire to be a multitasker. That's always how we referred to her. She was on the go. She didn't have time. Whether she had passion or not, she didn't have time. So we tried to give ourselves this character to, you know, build for, to talk to. But we didn't know what we were doing. And, you know, so we, and again, it was appealing to us. It was definitely speaking to this insight that we felt and we shared. And then as the brand grew and evolved, look, we, you know, brought in so many people on the team and they had to interpret. We had to eventually really make sure that we had brand guidelines, style guide, copy guides. And those things, you know, took shape with different people. They went awry, of course, as they do. And as social media took off, just trying to think about how we wanted to be in social.
Yeah.
That was something we had to continue to get our arms around.
So speaking of that, how have you kind of navigated the ever-changing world of social media and understanding how to get the brand onto these different platforms?
Oh my gosh.
As they evolve and keeping it all feel consistent and engaging.
It feels so insane today. It seemed more reasonable when we launched. We were really lucky because our first hire was from content, the world of content, and she loved it and she was so excited about things like Twitter happening and the changes in Facebook. And so it was very organic for her. She wanted to engage proactively in those channels and talk to her customers or like see that someone should sign up.
Yeah.
And it started that being kind of close to our DNA. That was what we were going to do. We knew that we were going to pair trial plus content plus commerce. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a mix of art and science. And so I think it's letting go a little bit. And that is really scary because brand is our number one asset.
It just feels like as of recent, people are starting to understand the value of content.
Yeah.
I mean, it's and as you're thinking about building business, it's a longer play, right? It's you aren't going to see the immediate ROI of if you kind of turn this paid ad spend on or off or
the amount of questions I get around that of like, can you prove the value of creating content? It is definitely clear that having content, and I say context, to help people understand what you're thinking, why you sent them something, or you know how it fits into their life. It's building that relationship, and that's what it's about.
You have become, I think, one of the most recognizable women leaders leading a company that has really changed the game for how other people even think about building their businesses. What is that like?
It feels like a privilege. That's the first thing I'll say. I think I really dream of being able to continue to help women think about their potential. That's definitely become a huge part of my motivation. I am super inspired by my team. I know that, I mean, I just have a lot of great female leaders that are doing this for the first time also with me. And, you know, it's incredible for me to recognize how much power we have that was grown at Birchbox, that came to Birchbox early. And I think that I feel it's really important to believe and understand that you already have what it takes. It's almost like a message to me and a message to people out there to be so inspired by my current team, because you know, it isn't some like a mythical thing that, you know, someday can happen. It's in us. It's in us now.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And it's about unlocking it. It's about really trying to get rid of the fear that's holding all of us back from seeing what's possible for us.